Hi, this is Heidi, episode 101, Drowning Thoughts. Life isn't a spectator sport. Success comes to those who show up every day with a pocket full of courage, grit, and a little sparkle. I'm glad you're here. Before I start, please make sure that you are subscribed to Hi, This is Heidi wherever you listen, Spotify, iTunes, so you get a new episode each Wednesday. When this episode is published, it will be several days after my 50th birthday. I'd love for you to give me a present by rating and reviewing and sharing Hi, This is Heidi. And if you do, please leave a comment on Facebook or Instagram. I've just started pushing episodes to LinkedIn, so you can comment there and I'll figure out how to see comments on LinkedIn. Last week on Instagram, Real Play by Heart, a listener said, "I'm so happy to see new episodes. I binge listened to all of your episodes until I caught up and felt like an important part of my day was missing when I listened to everything you'd put out. Your ideas have been life-changing for me." Oh, thank you very much to my listener, Real Play by Heart. Today's episode is called Drowning Thoughts, and it has been inspired by a story I heard a few months ago about the sinking of the Royal Charter ship in 1859 off the northern coast of England. The ship was carrying roughly 500 people returning home from Australia, destined for Liverpool, England. Now, on board were over 100 gold miners who had just struck large amounts of gold while mining in Australia. The ship got caught in a huge, huge storm, now known as the Royal Charter Storm, and almost every single person drowned. In fact, everyone might have drowned. The ship was, though, trying to anchor, and it wasn't too far from shore when it met its final demise. So hoping they could keep their gold and make it to land, the miners stuffed gold in their pockets and coats and tried to swim to shore, but they all drowned. When I heard this story, I was struck instantly by the symbolism of being weighed down by gold or anything that is esteemed as being so valuable and precious. By not letting go of this perceived valuable thing is one of the reasons why we drowned, why we might die. Now, it's easy in hindsight and outside the emotions of striking gold and living in hard and scrabble 17th century life to question why they didn't just leave the gold to save themselves. But I'm guessing they thought the gold was what would save them once their life was once back on land. And they didn't question if they could swim or reach shore, underestimating the force of the storm and overestimating their strength. Maybe, we're just guessing here. So picture these miners with coats and belts filled with gold that's pulling them underwater. And now think of ourselves as that person, and we're holding on to seemingly valuable and necessary beliefs, even believing they are as precious as gold. And if we would just let go of them, we could be above water, to shore, and save our lives. I've been gathering thoughts and beliefs for a bit that can be these, quote, drowning thoughts in certain situations. And if we can stand back and question the value of keeping the thoughts, we can then possibly let go. Now, all of these thoughts aren't bad, just like gold isn't bad. Gold is great, but it isn't great when you stuff your pockets with it and try to swim ashore in a storm. Having perspective and a coach to help wake us up to reality and common sense will help us see if we like the results of keeping the thoughts or not. The gold would have been very useful to these miners if they hadn't run into the storm. They just didn't know when to drop the gold for a more valuable result. Now, I'm going to go through several thoughts and situations, see which ring true for you, or see where a similar thought should be explored in your own head to see if it's keeping you underwater and further from your goals. Okay, drowning thought number one. I think my spouse should be different. Now, you insert the name of the person you really wish would be different for you to feel better. I'm just going to go with spouse or husband. Of course, my husband is perfect. I'm only saying that in case he's listening. In reality, wishing my husband would be different, or even in the past thinking he needed to change, this was and always is a very drowning thought. First, this drowning thought keeps us focused on other people who, turns out, we can't change. So this thought moves us away from what we have control over. And this thought drowns us because it keeps us from accepting then loving people in our lives. Here's one example. When we were building our house, I really wished my husband helped out more by having opinions about everything we had to pick out. I created so much more negativity for myself in an already stressful situation by wishing he were different. Instead, if I had just dropped that thought and focused on how amazing it was that I got to get 100% of my desires and wishes, I would have relieved myself of a lot of dirty stress. Now, that situation isn't as serious as other ways in which we wish others were different, wanting our children to have strengths other than the ones they have, keeps us underwater from seeing who they really are at the surface. There are a lot of other examples. I'm not going to give you more of this thought. I go into this in episode 59, wishing people were different, a lot more. So definitely listen to that episode if you haven't. Life is a lot lighter if we can just let go of the thought that people should be any different than they are. We have more energy to focus on things that matter, on getting our own lives to shore. Okay, drowning thought number two, this isn't fair. We all teach our kids from a young age that life isn't fair, but it's funny, as adults, we forget that this is a really useless and self-defeating thought. Of course life isn't fair. Of course it isn't fair that some people are born into families who can provide their needs and others into extreme poverty and abuse. When we focus and feel the belief that something in our life isn't fair, we put ourselves into the victim mode. We literally go underwater because of self-pity and victimhood. We give away our power. It's like we let go of the life preserver. It isn't fair that some spouses become alcoholics or incapacitated by addictions. Physical, emotional, financial abuse is wrong, and it isn't fair. I agree it isn't. None of this is good or fair. It isn't fair that there's cancer in the world. It isn't fair that some college students miss their freshman year or their graduation due to COVID. It isn't fair that there are extramarital affairs or furloughs or natural disasters. It isn't fair. I've known way too many friends, mothers of young children, to die and leave their husbands to raise their kids. Not fair. But holding on and feeding the belief that we're the victim and somehow life should be or could be fair is fighting with reality. Being mad that life isn't fair doesn't put food on the table and doesn't give a child a ride to after-school activities, or doesn't make us emotionally attractive people. There are very few instances where we can even make life equal. Now, if you're in a situation where you have the ability to impact social injustices, please, please continue to try and do this amazing work. It's just that most of us drown ourselves in the belief that life should be fair. Trust me, I'd like for life to be fair. But then I ask myself, what is even fair? What's the standard we use? We all have different definitions of fair, so we'd never even get a universally accepted standard. Instead, we have much more personal power when we drop this thought and we ask, what can I do in this situation? Who do I want to be in a family with a struggle, the hero or the victim? Who do I want to be working for a boss who seems to always pass me up for a promotion, confident or resentful? Taking back our power drops the drowning thoughts and allows us to focus on how we can make our lives and the lives of those around us better. Now, of course, and this is where using situational perspective is necessary. If you're distributing proceeds from your parents to siblings or buying your kids Christmas presents, by all means, distribute it equally. Knowing when to keep and when to let go of these thoughts is critical. Okay, drowning thought number three. A good mother does this, this, and this. Let's say we believe a good mother doesn't work outside of the home. A good mother has more than four children. A good mother doesn't put her needs above her kids' needs. A good mother makes homemade dinners each night. A good mother learns how to can peaches. You get where this is going. So much of the underlying beliefs of why we do things is because we believe we are good if we do these things. Maybe your belief is about what it means to be a good daughter or a good employer or a good employee. In reality, a lot of these thoughts probably are helpful and they get us results in life that we like. So even though the belief isn't a universal truth, if it creates momentum for us to do things with a neutral or positive attitude in life, go ahead and keep the thought. It becomes a drowning thought when the belief starts to weigh us down. Can't you picture yourself sinking at times when you think those thoughts? I'm very grateful I've been able to dismantle some beliefs and all or nothing attitudes about the type of mother I want to be. And I questioned some thoughts and beliefs I heard when growing up. Imagine that your spouse is laid off from their job. Your family has no income. Your family's ship is literally shaking and sinking in a storm, and you're offered a job to bring in income. This is a situation where the thought a good mom doesn't work outside the home could literally be a drowning thought. Now, you have to decide what's right for you, but it's important to decide if we're unwilling to drop the gold and if the belief really is useful at this particular moment. I mentioned canning peaches. I don't know how to can anything. I don't want to know how to can anything. I don't want to eat canned food. But for decades, I believed, because of religious and cultural messages, that pioneering habits and canning type skills and things like gardening were superior to other skills. Believing these things made me feel insecure. I doubted my superpowers, which are not these. I wanted a garden, but was never in town in the summers. And frankly, I don't like getting my hands dirty. It's a sensory thing. I wear gloves to wash dishes too. Now, of course, the pioneering attitude, super self-sufficiency skills are awesome, and I'm not against them at all. I have them in other areas of my life, but I was using the beliefs against myself. I was drowning in insecurity and was less willing to shine in my own ways. I was feeling less than and not measuring up to what was good. And it kept me from really admiring those with skills. When I noticed what I was doing, when I questioned these beliefs from all sides, I realized I could just drop them. I realized there were no superior or inferior skills. I realized it's okay for others to can, and it's okay for me not to want to can. Dropping the belief that some talents are better than others was one of the most life-saving things I could have done, and I'm so much happier because of it. Along the lines of a good employee or employer, when the COVID quarantine started, companies who could drop the belief or definition of where a good employee works could stop drowning faster than the employers who couldn't let go of this, or believing education had to be in person or whatever. Again, it's perspective and seeing the totality of the situation and knowing how and when to pivot. I'm so grateful my kids got an incredible remote academic experience, and I'm so grateful they're back in person now. Okay, another drowning thought. What are we on? Number four. If I lose weight or make money or insert something great happening and changing your life, I will make someone else feel bad. I've had these feelings before. I shared in another episode how when I got a new minivan, a friend of mine was visibly upset. It's true. If you lose weight, some friends, some family may be jealous. It is not a reason not to reach for your goals. It is true that if you get a big raise or a big promotion, some people will feel insecure or jealous. Their feelings are not about you. You are not making them feel this way. You cannot be overweight enough or so poor enough to make other people feel better about themselves. Now, yes, we want to be considerate and thoughtful about all aspects of our life, but the belief that our successes will make other people feel bad is a drowning thought. and will keep us farther from us being the best version of ourselves. We're in charge of our growth, of our future, of expanding our talents. We are not in charge of this for other people. And often we forget that by growing and achieving more, we also inspire others and have more capacity to give to others. So yes, others may feel however they want to feel with your success. You're still only in charge of how you think, feel, and act. Come on back into your lane. Another drowning thought that sounds really valuable is, I know what is best, or I know what is right for my child. Again, like other thoughts, this thought and belief could be useful in a lot of situations. We want our values to fuel how we teach our children, the opportunities we give them. I've just seen in so many situations where this thought pulls clients and myself underwater, so we aren't seeing how there could be another, quote, right for this child. Remember, we see our children through the lens of our life experiences, and that lens is created through our likes, dislikes, our strengths and weaknesses. Our children are different than us. They're being raised in a time with completely different social pressures, opportunities. Holding too tightly to, I know what is right, can drown us. I've been able to release this thought in the times when I can see it pulling me underwater by saying, I don't know what is best for this child in this situation. I think I might know what is best. I think we're helping them make the right decision, but I don't know what ultimately will be right or best. Those thoughts help me drop some of the gold thoughts. Real quick, a few more. A friend of mine who didn't finish college and has an incredibly successful business told me her business didn't really take off until she dropped the belief she needed a college degree to make money and succeed in business. She doubled her income the first year she decided to believe that that belief didn't apply to her, and she continues to be wildly successful. Years ago, a coworker was trying to leave a very abusive marriage where she and her children were very manipulated and abused. She believed strongly, though, that divorce was, quote, splitting up a family, and she didn't want to split up her family. She didn't want a, quote, broken family. Those were drowning thoughts for her at the time. Those thoughts didn't allow her to see the total picture and understand the brokenness already inherent in staying married to this person. By releasing her limited beliefs of what she wanted her family to look like, was she then able to literally save herself and her children? Another drowning thought is that debt is bad and should be avoided. In American cultures, we have common held beliefs that it's okay to go into debt for a home and maybe a car, but little else. And in a lot of cases, this is a useful thought. But borrowing money or debt, it isn't good or bad. It just is. Yes, most of us want to continue to believe that irresponsible debt is bad. That is helpful for us. But there may be times when borrowing money is exactly what we need to do to get to solid land. When we drop the belief, we take blinders off to make better informed decisions and incorporate more expertise, which may or may not lead to borrowing money to start a business or whatever it is. Speaking of money, a drowning belief I see myself dropping is that we have to work more hours to make more money. I worked for years in a management consulting position, and more billable hours was valued and rewarded. Recently, I had someone remark how I'd need to work more to make more. And that could be true for many people. But for myself, that isn't a belief getting me to my goals. Money doesn't have to be tied to an hourly measurement. We end up working smarter when we pivot and start believing it's possible to make more money in less time. This is also when we can drop exhaustion as a status symbol and the desire to always be busy. I'm pivoting to working less and making more, and it feels so good, and it's working. One last drowning thought, the thought that our prayers weren't answered in a past situation. I just saw in the news a family telling a health tragedy and how they prayed and prayed for a miracle and it didn't come. They were so sad and despondent. And the truth is that probably the exact thing they prayed for didn't happen for their son. But believing and continuing to think God wasn't watching over them and wasn't giving them other miracles is only going to pull them under and keep them further from peace and acceptance. Dropping this thought can feel vulnerable. It can feel hard. I get it. But what's the alternative? We stay resentful and sad and drowned? Instead, if we can just drop the belief and start focusing on how we are blessed in other times of need, we fill our life with oxygen and peace. We have more strength to make it to more solid land. So of course these thoughts I've shared with you here are just the beginning. We all have things we believe that we need help dismantling. Again, just like the gold the miners had mined and were bringing home, many of these beliefs and thoughts are useful to us most of our life. We just need to develop the ability to manage our thoughts, to be aware of what we're believing, what is driving our actions, and to drop them when they suddenly become drowning thoughts. Okay, that's it for this week. If you would like personalized weekly private one-on-one coaching to help you drop your drowning thoughts and beliefs and to find solid confidence, sign up for a consult call at HeidiBenjaminson.com. It's free. A confident mother is the greatest gift to her family, not a perfect mother. Our families want us to be confident, anchored, and calm. I can help you uncover this version of yourself. Have a great week.